My name's Nachi Marsham. I'm an executive editor with Disney Publishing. I'm also known as the guy you don't care about on this panel, so thank you for hearing us all. I have the great fortune to be the editor of an illustrated book series that's going to be coming out in January of 2015 that is written by Mr. Stan Lee. It's exciting to me as it is for all of you, and we've been talking about it for a couple of years now. Without further ado, our guest, Mr. Stan Lee.
Oh my God, we have an audience. Now, this is the man who knows facts. He will tell you all the facts. After he's given you the facts, I'll do my usual confusing you and saying all the wrong things. Every time I'm on the stage and I address you, when I go backstage, all the people say, "But Stan, you shouldn't have said that. But how come you didn't mention that?" I get those lectures, so I may stay here longer with him, so I don't have to put up with that. Okay, you have your own mic.
I do have my own mic.
It's a very luxurious organization. He has a mic. Money is no object.
Very nice suit you put on.
Okay, go get him, Nachi.
All right. So, as I was saying, I'm editing this book that Stan has co-written called Zodiac Legacy. It'll be coming out January 27th of 2015. That we have some artwork to be able to show while we're kind of rattling on. But what I wanted to talk to Stan about, the royal we, I'm speaking for like all of Disney Publishing now, was mainly about the importance of all ages storytelling. And you have been involved in some really cool action adventure stories over the years. A couple that people have heard of. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about just the importance of being able to do stories and be able to create stories that can reach out to a wide audience across age ranges especially.
Yeah, it's very important.
Excellent, we're done here.
Why, everybody loves to have me as a guest. Very important. It's all right, I'm going to do it now.
Thank you.
What was the question? Oh, the importance of something, brother. And the big thing is you try to write something that young people will enjoy because it's simple enough for them to understand and it's exciting enough to hold their interest, but you try to write it, hopefully, intelligently enough so that an older reader will enjoy it also. Now, the thing with Zodiac, it's for all ages. Did you mention that it is one of the world's greatest illustrated novels? Because how many pages, this is a novel, a hardcover book, but how many pages of illustrations are there?
About 60, 55 or so, some of which you can see up here.
There you go. Now, nobody will stay here for the whole speech. They'll all be running out to buy the book when they see those great illustrations. All right, that's about it. Can I go now?
In like 20 to 25 more minutes, and then also the rest of the day, and then I think they have you all of tomorrow as well. All these people came here for you. I also want to talk to you a little bit about bad guys, because you've been involved in the creation of some fantastic, some of my favorite villains across any kind of storytelling over the years, from Dr. Doom to Magneto to the Green Goblin and beyond. I think you could talk a little bit about what your approach has been to creating some really cool bad guys, different from one another.
It probably says something about my character, but it's a lot easier to create bad guys than heroes. I love the villains. Now, I'm going to talk to you very seriously about Dr. Doom. Those of you who don't know who Dr. Doom is, feel free to occupy yourselves with something for a few minutes. I do not consider Dr. Doom a lawbreaker, and I'm going to tell you why. What does the man really want? He wants to conquer the world. Well, if you were a lawyer, you would admit, you'd be the first to admit, there is no law against wanting to conquer the world. Dr. Doom could walk up to a policeman and say, "Excuse me, officer, I want to conquer the world." Cop would say, "Good luck to you. You're not breaking the law." So why does everybody consider him a villain? See, I give him the hard questions. Well, anyway, I probably confused everybody. Did I answer what you asked? What
did you answer when I asked? Yes. That guy thinks so. And then speaking of kind of characterization in world, something that people will hopefully see in Zodiac when it's out in January is a wide assortment of characters and powers, but also characters that are very grounded in the real world. And when Andy Tong is the name of the artist who's created everything that you're seeing up on stage behind, and a couple of years ago when Andy was turning in character concepts to us based off of a lot of the notes and early story that we were seeing, one of the things that you brought up to us during an art review was talking a lot about grounding the characters in reality, and for as bombastic as their powers might be, that it's even more important to make sure that it feels like you could see them walking around in the street. And that was really cool for me as someone who grew up with a lot of the stuff that you're putting out there. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about that to all of these folks today.
About grounding the villains in reality?
The heroes and the villains, but just making
see, he doesn't realize when he talks into this thing so that you'll hear him, I can't understand a word he says. Because it sounds to me like...
It sounds to me like, too.
Put the mic down for a minute and tell me what you want.
One moment.
A balanced world where superheroes could feel like they could be walking amongst you. And, well, they are. Look at me. I'm amongst you and you take me for granted. I don't know if I'm a hero or a villain. But anyway, the important thing... Well, let me go back to fairy tales. The reason I think that the kind of stories we do are popular is because they're really fairy tales for grown-ups. Think of it. When you were young, you all, I'm sure without exception, every one of you loved to read fairy tales. Even you. But what happens is you get a little bit older. You know, you're not going to read fairy tales when you're 12, 13, 15, or 45 years old. So you outgrow them. But I don't think you ever outgrow your love for those kind of stories of monsters and dragons and witches and evil magicians. And all of a sudden, you have these superhero stories in comic books and in the movies. And they're just like the fairy tales that you read as a kid, because these people have these extra powers and they're threatening everybody else, and the lone hero or group of heroes has to protect you from them. So they're fairy tales for older people, and that's why you love them so much, and never be ashamed to admit you love them so much, because that's what they are and you should love them. How's that? And I probably didn't even answer his question, which I totally forgot what it was.
Actually, that story was really good, and I kind of forgot what the question was in the first place, because I just got excited about you talking about storytelling some more. This has been an ongoing problem with working on the book. I just kind of
didn't understand a word he's saying.
That was all for.
You want to talk to the mic? I don't know what the hell he's saying. Okay, you talk to them. They'll tell me.
Okay. And now, I'm just going to ask a complete kind of nerd-bait question because I'm on stage with Stanley and I'm a little excited about it. I'll ask you guys first and then mention it to him. So, Stan, I'll say to him, do you have a favorite villain from all of the creators that you, characters that you created over the years?
Oh, I love all my villains. They're my best friends. I love the Green Goblin, I love Galactus, I love Dr. Doom, I love Doc Ock. I don't know if you ever thought about it, but we're the only company, I think I was the first writer, to give these characters nicknames. I mean, well, let's say you were reading Batman. Nobody ever called him Batty. I called Spider-Man Spidey. And I called Dr. Octopus Doc Ock, mainly because I couldn't remember the whole name. But I love the villains, and I love giving them nicknames, and I love getting to know all about them. you've got to understand what motivates a villain. Usually greed or money or whatever the hell it is. And you got to get the reader to love the villain and almost half wish the villain wouldn't get defeated so he'll be back again next issue. I love the heroes are okay. The right heroes are okay. But it's the villains that make the stories. He wants to tell you about my work in the Army doing... What happened was, I was in the Signal Corps. They were about to ship me overseas. And my job was to climb telegraph by these poles that they had and establish the electric wiring so that the troops who followed me could communicate with each other. So I was to go ahead of the infantry. Anyway, that was my job. I was all set to be shipped. I was waiting on the dock for the ship. A guy pokes me on the shoulder and says, didn't you used to write comics? I said, yeah. He said, well, we're transferring you to the Army Film School. They have a training film area where they did training films for the troops, and you wrote books for the troops. What happened was it was taking too long to teach the troops how to use some of the complicated weapons or how to do all the things they had to do, like how to operate a tank and so forth. And they wanted the booklets and the training films made simpler. So they went to the simplest guy they could find. And it was my job to take all these complicated manuals and rewrite them. And I even did little cartoons. I'll tell you something that's totally unglamorous. One of the problems they had, the payroll officers were taking too long to work out the payrolls for the troops. So there'd be some guy in Europe getting his butt shot off in combat, and he wasn't getting paid in time, and it was lousy for morale. So my job was to teach the payroll officers how to do their job faster and do their payroll. I know about as much about payroll as I do about atomic energy, but that was my job. So I made up a character called Fiscal Freddy, and I made up a game that you played on one page, and you had to get Freddy from the top of the page to the bottom of the page. But in order to do that, he had to answer trick questions. So I made a game out of it, and they all were doing the Fiscal Freddy game, and they were able to teach the payroll officers much faster than before. So the troops started getting paid, and this is why you come to these conventions. You learn things you never knew before. I single-handedly helped to win the war by paying the troops. Funny thing, I think it's funny. The payroll officers had a problem that they didn't feel needed. They didn't feel glamorous enough. They needed something to make them feel better. So I said I will write a marching song for them, for the payroll department. So when they marched around the field, they could sing their song. And I took the tune of the Army Air Corps song. You know that one? Off we go into the wild blue yonder. So I wrote for the payroll officers. Off we go into our office yonder, at our desk morning till night. Far away from any battle's thunder, we pay off the fellas who fight. Clerks alert, guarding our books from blunder. Payroll forms clutter the floor. We write, compute, sit tight to boot. Nothing will stop the fiscal director. And you wonder why we won the war.
Not anymore.
I never did that before. Thanks for listening, for bearing with me. Dave, you haven't asked a lot of questions.
No, you did, and honestly, that was kind of the tail end of what I have.
You can make notes if you wish.
I don't even know how I would follow that up with anything. And plus, we have to kind of wrap ourselves up anyway. So I wanted to thank you, Stan, for taking the time to...